Well, let's talk a little bit about, so the protein intake, and you're talking about people giving pushback. There definitely are animal studies that have looked at, caloric restriction and protein restriction and its effect on how lab rodents live and how healthy they live. And I think that, as you and I have talked off camera, there's a lot of different types of people that are in different life stages. We've got obese people, like sedentary, that could probably benefit from caloric restriction. We've got young, healthy, physically active people that are probably needing more protein intake. We've got the older people that are battling sarcopenia that probably need more protein intake. And then we have the whole fasting community. So, I mean, it's like, I've had a lot of fasting experts on the podcast, as you know, and I think what a better job it needs to be done is basically just talking about the audience, talking about, okay, who are we speaking to here with this specific thing we're talking about? Because it's important. There's different people in different stages of life. And then I think also with some of the protein restriction as well, very similar. And I've listened to some of the things that you've talked about with, extrapolating data from lab animals, specifically on caloric restriction and dietary restriction, protein restriction to humans, may be a little murky because of something called this disuse and disease that humans are just so susceptible to. So can you talk a little bit about that? Because it makes so much sense.
Yeah, I mean, the writer's statement, I think, and the disclaimer right at the start is to say, tremendous amount of respect for the science of the people that do the studies around caloric restriction, protein restriction, et cetera. Most of it is done, as you mentioned, in lab animals, mostly small rodents, so usually mice or rats sometimes. And I think one of the things that's important to point out is when we've compared primates head to head, so this is in caloric restriction, arguably the most robust model of survival, extending lifespan, the data is actually conflicting. It's only been done, obviously, in two different locations. And so if you were a primate, in one location, you did better than primates in the other, but the net result was it actually didn't extend lifespan. So that sort of makes you think, okay, maybe it's not as clear-cut as you might think. Obviously, small rodents, they're mammals, so the extrapolation to us is often done. Drug companies do it all the time, I understand. I think the thing that I focus on the most is around, there's a caged animal that lives in a very controlled environment, and food is, there is no fluctuation in food. It's sort of held at here or here because it's given or taken away from the animal. So, choice is taken away from the animal. The human beings are notoriously sometimes great, sometimes not so much at making. And these animals aren't exposed to a lot of the same stressors. So one of the concepts that we and it was something in reading a good friend of mine, Doug Padden-Jones, who sadly passed away really early in his life, pointed out at these catabolic crises that we have. And for him, it meant a period of hospitalization. And during this event, the de facto treatment in hospital is you go into bed rest. And we've known for years that putting people in bed rest, and you can ask any clinician, it's a bad situation. You're not using your muscles, you become instantly sedentary, obviously. And it would exacerbate a lot of other issues if you went into bed rest with type 2 diabetes, you were overweight, et cetera, et cetera. So these events, you can appreciate bed rest and a catabolic crisis if you've got a hospital event is, that's going to be bad. I get that. So we sort of said, well, dial it back a little bit. Maybe you get flu and you're an older person, you get some respiratory distress, you go into hospital for a few days, you're on oxygen, but now you're fine to be released from the hospital, but you go home and convalesce for 2 weeks. So this is a disuse event, relatively speaking, but you're okay, but you sit around for 2 weeks. And we think as you get older, even those types of events are a disuse event that we think precipitates an issue. And I was fond of saying that, well, you know, this happens every year and, well, it happens everywhere because people get the flu. And I said, but there's maybe a uniquely, if not Canadian, but northern U.S. phenomenon that when it's freezing cold outside, you also, as an older person, you don't go outside. You don't want to shovel your snow. You could slip. You could, you know, so... And clinicians would say, yeah, but you know, how often does that happen? Then COVID comes along, and I said, happens a lot. So I feel a little bit of vindication. I said, this is a relevant model. And what happens is if you can imagine somebody's, they're already going down because sarcopenia is happening. When they have a disuse event, they bend the curve dramatically. So there's an accelerated rate of muscle loss. And what happens, when you're younger, you go down, but you're able to bounce back up. At some point, and this is universally, I think, understood by clinicians, is that an older person that has that event like that is actually now on a different downward trajectory. So they've actually hopped, you know, they've accelerated the loss that they have with aging to a fairly large degree. The best, you know, way to explain it to people is to say you put somebody up in space because there's no gravity. That's effectively disuse because you can't really generate any force with your muscles. And we know that, you know, 6 months or a year spending up at the space station is about 10 to 15 years of skeletal and muscle aging. And it's tough to get back. In fact, most of those astronauts, I'd be willing to bet, don't get much of that back when they come even down to Earth. So that's the price you pay for a little bit of weightlessness for about 6 months to a year.
Wow. Yeah, that's incredible about the astronauts. But just speaking to like what you were saying with the disuse and disease, again, it makes a lot of sense because laboratory rodents are not really exposed to that. They're in these little sterile environments that are, you know. So, you know, I think, you know, again, at the end of the day, just to kind of get this, I think, to make it clear to people listening here today, you know, I still do think there are benefits to different types of intermittent fasting for different people. And whether we're talking about someone that's obese and overweight, you know, being having a form of caloric deficit, which can be achieved a lot of ways, including probably the best. I mean, like exercise. If exercise is probably the cornerstone of healthspan, right?
Sure, absolutely.
I mean, like that's
absolutely.
I think we agree there.
But
also, like, there's different types of fasting. You know, there's the constant caloric restriction, like we were just talking about. Mm-hmm. But there's also just not eating 2 to 3 hours before bed.
Sure.
And that's something I think most people can benefit from, honestly, because you're not that is as insulin sensitive later in the evening, and it's nice to have a period where you do have some rest, digestion and everything. So lots of types of fasting, and you know, that all gets lost again when we just kind of talk about it in this big umbrella kind of type of generalization.
Yeah.